Laurie.
Hi. Actually, good morning, everybody. I just wanted to share, there were a lot of questions during the finance section about access to capital. So we wanted to share that the Hawaii Small Business Development Center, we have centers on all the major islands. So on Maui, Hawaii, we have two, and Kauai and Oahu, we have our center. I'm a senior business advisor with the Oahu Center, and James Tenrai. So James has, and we work with Joe Burns at the Oahu Center. James has a background in investment banking. And I have banking background of 30 plus years. So what we wanted to share with you is that if you have questions about access to capital financing, you're not sure how to put together your packet, feel free to seek our assistance. If on the neighbor islands, we have also advisors on all the major islands as well. But just wanted to share that with you before you meet with the lender. If you're not sure, if you want to talk to us, you know, we're no cost. We just wanted to just share that piece with you that our services are available to you as well.
Okay, everyone. I'd like to next introduce John Holman. He's the director of the local office here in Hawaii for the U.S. Commercial Service. His office is over in the old building right above mine in the foreign trade zone over here. You've been in this job for how long now?
9 years.
Wow, great. And he's a great resource for what is available from the U.S. government, the Commercial Service, the Department of Commerce, and what have you. For that, he's also involved very much with our Hawaii Pacific Export Council activities. And he'll leave his contact information at the end, I'm sure, but he's very integral to what's going on with exporting from Hawaii to Asia Pacific, Europe, Latin America, Canada, Mexico, wherever you're interested in exporting. John is a great resource, so please make sure you get his contact information. With that, John, please go ahead.
Aloha, everyone. Good morning. Buckle up. I've got a lot of information for you. It's going to fly by. It's going to be like drinking out of a fire hose. As Rob mentioned, my name's John Holman. I have the best job in the world. I'm the director of the Pacific for the U.S. Commercial Service, U.S. Department of Commerce, and our mission is to help companies like yours do business in markets all over the globe. So finding partners, navigating customs logistics, protecting your intellectual property, all of those things we can assist you with. And today, I want to look at some of the strategy behind developing your export plan or export strategy for your business, some of the resources that we have available for you, and a lot of good things to tickle your interest. So Rob, first slide. I'm going to start off. I've been doing this job for almost 10 years, working with companies, helping them grow internationally. And what I've learned is that export success can be boiled down to three key things. And I'm just going to lead off with that, because if you leave with anything from this presentation today, these are the three things that you need to know. Rob? Okay, number one. The first one, I can't do anything to help you with, but it's critically important, and that is motivation. I've seen companies with an average product, but they get after the market, they travel overseas, they go meet with buyers, they attend trade shows, they connect with people in their industry, and they find a way to succeed. Conversely, I've seen a Hawaii company with a $1 billion product. It's a fantastic product with multiple applications in different industry sectors, but the owner isn't willing to put money into developing a sales team to get out and promote the product, and they've been having middling success for years. A couple years ago, I had a gentleman come to me about 5 years ago, and he said, I don't know anything about exporting. I just left the IT business. I'm starting an export company. What should I do? I gave him some advice. I sent him away. I said, contact me when you've done these things, and we'll see what we can do to help you. 99% of the time, I never hear from that person again. A few weeks later, this guy came back and he said, I just did all those things. What's next? Great. I gave him some more homework to do and some more market intelligence to review. He came back and he said, what now? He went overseas to Canada. He attended some trade shows. He started making sales. He was representing some companies on the Big Island and then Maui. And now, 5 years later, he's selling to half a dozen countries around the world. He has numerous Hawaii companies that he works with where he takes their products and gets them into markets around the world. And he's doing a very good business. And it's all about motivation. So remember that. Number two, identifying the path of least resistance. So what markets can you get into in the least amount of time with the lowest cost and the least effort and then generate the greatest return? This is critically important. When companies contact our office, the top two markets they typically are interested in are Japan and China. And those are two of the most difficult countries for a new exporter to get into if they haven't had any experience doing business internationally before. Not to say that Japan can't be a good market. Certainly it's an important trading partner for Hawaii. But if you've never done business internationally, there are a lot of other markets that are going to be easier to get into where you can generate a return faster, and then you can reinvest that experience and revenue stream into new markets. So identifying that path of least resistance for your business is critical. Next, please. And then third, having great partners to work with on the foreign side. As you know, it's important to work with customers or partners in Hawaii or on the mainland that you can trust, that are responsive to you, that represent your brand well, and it's even magnified when you're doing business internationally because you're dealing with a partner and a market where the language may be different, the culture is certainly different. There are a lot of variables that you don't understand and you will never understand, but your partner does. And so finding the best partner to represent you, your brand, your business, and be responsive and ensure that you're successful is critical. These are the three most important keys to doing business internationally. So just remember those. Next slide, please. A quick overview. What are Hawaii's top exports? We get this asked this question all the time. About 98% of Hawaii's exports are in services. Our number one service export is tourism, followed by education and training. This is when foreign visitors or students come to Hawaii and spend money on experiences, tour agencies, restaurants, in the case of students, books, tuition. These are service exports. In addition, architecture, engineering services are huge. And then we have products, consumer products. That's what a lot of people tend to focus on when they're thinking about exporting. We see a lot of companies successful in cosmetics and skincare, typically with Hawaii branding or tropical attributes, environmental technologies, increasing green technologies or consulting services, and then all these agriculture and processed foods. For many years, Hawaii's number one product export was bottled water. It's now been surpassed by broodstock shrimp. Seafood is in the top 10, coffee, papaya, macadamia nuts, organic honey. Those are some of the top product exports. Next slide, please. What's happening in the world? Right now, the red bar at the top there, 2014, this is GDP composition. So the Pacific Rim currently comprises about 55% of global GDP, and then skipping ahead to 2030, it jumps up to 65, and by 2050, 75% versus the rest of the world. Hawaii is in prime position to connect with many of these markets. Next slide, please. Global consumption. We see the same trend, but different dynamics in the sense red here represents advanced economies and blue is emerging economies. Currently, advanced economies 70% of global consumption, and that is shifting dramatically towards emerging economies, so it's going to be a balanced 50-50 in the next 15 years or so. Next slide, please. Future income gains. So these are the countries in the world where people's incomes are rising the fastest, and in countries where people's incomes rise, they trade up. They start buying disposable goods that maybe they couldn't afford before. And if they have certain goods that they buy now, they're trading up for more luxury goods or higher end goods. And that's where Hawaii can stand to benefit. Here we see Philippines number one, followed by China, Peru, Malaysia, Indonesia, and on down. Now, this doesn't mean that these are the best markets for you per se, but I hope to just get you thinking about what's happening in the world and where there may be potential for your business in the future. Next slide, please. Now we're going to talk about discovering the path of least resistance for your business, which is critical. We're going to do a little quiz, a little pop quiz, and I have some prizes for you. This is the basic guide to exporting. You can download it for free on export.gov, but what's even better is a printed version, which I have right here. Next slide, please. Okay, now, can anyone name the best place to do business in the world? Now, this is based on the World Bank. Each year they publish the Ease of Doing Business Index on number 1 through 197, all the countries in the world, in about a dozen metrics on how easy it is to do business there. So can anyone name, guess, what the number one best place to do business in the world is?
U.S.?
No, the U.S. is 8.
Canada.
Canada is about 15.
Vietnam.
I'm sorry? Shout them out. Just shout them out.
Singapore.
Singapore used to be number one. Great guess. It's now number two.
Denmark
is number three. Good guesses.
Vietnam.
Vietnam is way below. It's like 90. Yeah. What?
New Zealand.
James, New Zealand. But you already have one of these books, don't you?
No, I don't have.
Okay, this one's yours. All right. New Zealand is the new number one best place to do business in the world, followed by Singapore, followed by Denmark, and then Hong Kong, and then South Korea. Now, what's interesting is the difference between those top five is pretty small, but those are all great places to do business, generally speaking. Now, can anyone name the top four most populous nations in the world? I'll give you the first three, okay? China, India, the United States. What's number four?
Indonesia.
Indonesia is correct. That's right, Mark. I think you already have one of these books, so you can. Okay. All right. Mark is barred from answering any further questions. But Indonesia has about 230 million people, and it's one of the fastest growing markets in the world. It's averaged about 7% GDP growth over the last decade, which is faster growth than China more recently. Now, Indonesia is not the easiest place to do business, but just get you thinking about what's happening in the world and where there may be opportunities. Now, the United States has free trade agreements with four countries in the top 25. Can anyone name those four? Now, you can raise your hand, see if you can take a shot at it. In the back there. Zero. Good guesses, though. This is a tough one.
For sure, Singapore.
Singapore is one.
Russia?
Russia is not one. Free trade agreements. These are allies of the United States in terms of trade. Okay, Canada is one of those, and Singapore is another. Mexico's not in the top 25. So we've got two to go.
Korea,
that's correct. And then one more.
Australia.
Jamie, you get a book and this gentleman gets a book as well. Okay, now, Japan is Hawaii's number one trading partner. It's fourth for the US overall. But where does it rank in the ease of doing business worldwide? Good guess. It's 34. You get a book as well. And I mention that because a lot of companies in Hawaii, they think Japan first. We have a lot of cultural connections to Japan, a lot of visitors from Japan. Maybe you have some customers or people coming into your store, they're interested in your products. And not to say Japan isn't a good market, it's a great market. But there are 33 other countries where it's easier to do business than Japan. So is Japan the path of least resistance for your business? It's worth considering. Now China, that's another market we hear a lot about. It's growing rapidly. A lot of entrepreneurs think that if they can sell one widget to a billion Chinese, they'll be a billionaire. It's not quite that easy, but can anyone guess where China ranks? It's been moving up lately.
45?
No, higher. Oh,
10.
James?
I was gonna say lower, 80.
Very close. It's 78 right now. It was 90 about 5 years ago. It's moved up to 84. It's now 78. So still up there, 78, right? Next slide, please. So let's look at these rankings. The new number one, New Zealand, Singapore, Hong Kong, South Korea, United States, 8. Australia, where we have a free trade agreement, 15. Canada, 22. And then I've just put in some other markets here for reference, such as Switzerland at 31. There's Japan at 34. Another country of free trade agreement, Mexico at 47, Israel 52, Rwanda 56, 22 places higher than China. How many people thought about exporting to Rwanda? Well, it's easier than China. Vietnam 82, Indonesia 91, Philippines, a market a lot of Hawaii companies are interested in, at 99. It's been moving up a little bit. It was about 109 a few years ago. India at 130, Iraq 165, and Burma, which is opening up. A lot of US companies are interested in getting into the market, is below Iraq at 170. Next slide, please. Everyone asks me what those metrics are for the World Bank Ease of Doing Business Index, and here they are: starting a business, construction permits, getting electricity, registering property. Now, these may not apply to your business directly, but they're a sign, a metric, of how organized a country is, how efficient the rule of law applies, how your intellectual property will be treated, and how likely you are to get paid. All important issues. Next slide, please. I love this. I just came across this quote about Americans doing business in China and their perspective. And this gentleman here says, if some guy tells you he's got to get into China and mentions the market potential of 1.4 billion here, you just want to punch him in the face. This is from an American entrepreneur in China. Not to dissuade you, but just think about your path of least resistance for your business. And for most companies, I would say don't even think about China until you're already doing business in 10 to 20 countries. Then look at the China market. And then a few other quotes here from companies that have struggled in China. Next slide, please. In identifying the path of least resistance, there is this graph here. And the purpose of this graph is to look at the value of the market and the complexity of the market. Canada is in number 22, so definitely a less complex market. The value may not be as high. It's going to be a pretty competitive market. A lot of U.S. companies doing business there. It's the United States' number one trading partner. But as we move along, so China, for example, is going to be a lot more complex, and the potential value is likely higher as well. Okay? Now, when you're starting out, you want to start off with low complexity, and even if it's a more moderate value, and then build that revenue stream and experience, and then move towards higher value markets as you move along. Next slide, please. Another key thing is culture. And the purpose of this slide is to just highlight all the different elements of culture that maybe you haven't thought about when you're looking at doing business in another country. And every country is different. Next slide. This is a kind of a fantastic resource, this book, Kiss, Bow, and Shake Hands. And I have a copy in my office. Before I travel internationally for business, I always pull this book out and do a refresh on what's happening in this country. What are the cultural norms? Do you show up, make sure you show up early or late, or what's normal for this market? A quick example, in Japan, if you show up late, those partners in Japan will not do business with you. They'll be polite, they'll take your meeting, but afterwards they will not do business with you. In Japan, you don't show up on time, you show up early. You're there before the meeting, ready to go. In Brazil, it's a different story. The person you're meeting may show up an hour, 2 hours late. It's no big deal, okay? So understanding what those norms are and how they affect your business, your ability to do business in that country are critically important. Next slide, please.
Sorry to interrupt you, but David Day recommended this book also.
Great.
So I've read it too, and I pull it out sometimes just to, when I'm going to a new country. It's very, very useful.
Next slide, please. Going global. Now we're going to talk about some of the things you need to think about for your business in developing your export strategy. Next slide, please. First of all, what kind of domestic success have you had? If you have a brand new product or service, you haven't sold outside, or you haven't even sold in the US yet, most international partners don't want to be your guinea pig. That being said, if you have a product or service that's sold in the US, it's found a niche in the market, I guarantee you we can find some markets overseas where customers are going to be interested in your product or service. Now, what are the attributes? What do people like about your product or service? And do those attributes translate to the market you're looking to target? Oftentimes they do, but sometimes they may not. A good example is poi, right? We all know and love poi. You may make the best poi in Hawaii, but you decide to take it internationally, you might have a bit of an uphill challenge convincing consumers in other countries that this is a fantastic tasting food. But just looking at your product or service, what are those attributes that are valued by your customers, that they're willing to pay good money for, and will those translate? What's your production capacity? This is one issue we see come up with a lot of Hawaii companies. If we find you a partner in Canada and your sales go up by 15% in the next 3 months, can you meet that demand? A lot of Hawaii companies cannot. So you need to build that into your export strategy and prepare for that growth, because the worst thing that can happen is you get a big order, your partner on the other side is really excited, and then you can't deliver. And they're not going to want to work with you again in the future. Do you have the financial resources to grow your business? And I think we've had some other people talk about finance in here. And if you don't have the resources, that's okay. But build into your plan, into your strategy, what resources do you need to tap into in order to grow your business? Are you committed to exporting? A lot of businesses say, you know what, the economy's not going great right now in the US. I think I'll look at international markets for export as a side thing. But that is a strategy that typically fails, because when business picks up domestically, those foreign customers are neglected and your business overseas tends to suffer. Do you have an international plan with goals? This is important, and that's why we have this program, Export University, and the High Step program, to help you think through your strategy and execute it so that it's successful. Sometimes companies will say, you know what, I just went to Brazil for the Rio Olympics. It was fantastic. I think my product will do great there. Well, maybe you learn some things about the market, but is Brazil the path of least resistance? Is it a good market for you? Maybe, maybe not. And know-how. Do you understand the logistics, documentation that you need for your product, taxes and tariffs, how it's going to affect you, methods of payment, how to get paid is critically important. If not, that's okay. That's one of the things that my office is here for, and some of the partners are here to help you with, answer those questions or get those answers for you. Next slide, please. Common mistakes. Not having a real export plan, not being fully committed to exporting as a core part of your business strategy. Neglecting your local customers, I'm sorry, your export customers for local customers when business picks up domestically. Reliance on inadequate partnerships. This happens a lot overseas where you're contacted by someone and they say, hey, we want to represent you in Japan. And you say, great, I'm not doing anything there yet. We'll sign on the dotted line and you can represent me. But then 2 or 3 years go by and you realize that that partnership isn't representing your brand, maybe in the way that you need it to or wanted to. Maybe the sales are well below what your expectations were. Maybe they've even damaged your brand in that market, make it more difficult for you, and it's cost you time and money. So finding good partners, that was one of the top three things, is critically important from the beginning. Failure to modify your products for the market. The famous example is in the 1970s, the Chevy Nova. Does everyone remember that little car? Nova. Chevy took that car to Mexico and Latin America, and Nova means no go in Spanish, and it failed miserably. More recently, a lot of US companies have gone into China and they've just translated their English names into Chinese to disastrous effects. Look up Microsoft. Next slide, please.
That looks like you at Lanny Cut Beach.
No, that guy's a little tanner than me, you can see, but. When you're looking at your product potential, I said, as I mentioned, look at your domestic market success. What are some of the unique features or attributes? Maybe there's some elements of your product or service that maybe even in the US market, people aren't as attracted to, but maybe even more appealing overseas. And so ideally, you have multiple products that you might want to test out when you're going to market, because maybe that second or third tier product that isn't your leading product actually is more attractive in the market that you're targeting. Conducting some international market research is critical, identifying that path of least resistance. Where are you getting hits on your website from? There are numerous tools that you can use to gauge where are visitors coming from around the world to visit your website, inquiries that you're getting, or sales that you're making via e-commerce. And then where are your competitors selling? This can tell us where there's potential for your product. We had a Noni juice company come to us a couple years ago and they said, we're interested in selling to the Netherlands. Is that a good market for us? So I contacted my colleagues in the Netherlands. They came back and they said, good news and bad news. Good news is there's definitely a market for Noni juice in the Netherlands. Bad news is there's already 9 companies doing business here. It's not that big of a country. It's oversaturated. But looking at where your competitors are selling can give you an indication of where there may be potential. Next slide, please. The purpose of this slide is to show you if the top line is everything you do in the United States for your business in terms of how you go about running your business and finding customers and distributing your products, every country you do business in, that method of business is going to be a little bit different. So you need to go in with an open mind about what kind of partners that you need, what they're going to do for you on the ground, and what your needs are in that market. And it may vary. Next slide, please. Has anyone heard of Incoterms, international commercial terms? We had one hand from the foreign trade zone and another gentleman here. This is important. These three-letter abbreviations here indicate what you have to pay when you're doing business with a foreign customer, and at what point title to the goods transfer over from you to the buyer. And if something happens to those goods, who's liable for those expenses up to that point in the transfer? And so these are negotiating points as well. You want to make sure that you understand these terms, and when you're negotiating, you identify the term or the point at which in the process is most beneficial to you, and work out something that is agreeable to your partner as well. Next slide, please. Quick touch on free trade agreements. Next slide. In simple terms, free trade agreements make it cheaper and easier for U.S. companies to export. We've heard a lot about free trade agreements in the news recently, but the bottom line is the agreements that are in place make it cheaper and easier for you to export. I took a slide out, but basically it has all these really impressive numbers that U.S. companies that export to free trade agreement countries, the dollar value of their goods are much higher, and U.S. companies that export into free trade agreement countries tend to do much better over the long term. Next slide, please. These are all the countries that we currently have free trade agreements with, and we mentioned a few earlier when we did the quiz. Next slide, please. Now I'm going to share with you a little bit about our agency, the U.S. Commercial Service, and all of the resources that we have to bear to help you with your business. Next slide, please. Our agency has 250 offices in 80 countries around the globe to help you with your business. And the last time we calculated this figure, this is a return on investment. For every dollar in taxpayer funding we received, we generated $215 in sales for U.S. companies. Pretty good return on investment. Not many government agencies can quantify that. Next slide, please. Our services can be broken down in these four main categories here. Next slide. Market research, critical to identifying your path of least resistance. And on our website, export.gov, you have access to thousands of reports on both countries and sectors. So countries, if you Google Peru, you'll get a report that's called the Country Commercial Guide, and that's everything you need to know about doing business in Peru from a U.S. perspective. What's going on in their economy, their government, what are the best prospect sectors for U.S. companies, what are common market entry strategies, all this high-level overview of what's going on in that country, and we update those reports annually. There are also sector-specific guides. So if you have a cosmetics product, you can go Cosmetics Hong Kong and pull up a report on what's happening in Hong Kong, in the Hong Kong market for the cosmetics industry, major trends, what are some of the registration requirements if applicable, are there major trade shows that you want to think about attending to help boost your business in that country. Next slide, please. Trade events. We take trade missions of U.S. companies over to countries overseas, usually it's set up by sector, so we'll take over some green energy companies, or we'll take over some engineering companies to a particular market where there's great potential. There's also the International Buyer Program. These are about 30 major U.S. trade shows where we bring foreign buyers to the United States each year. Most of those shows are in Las Vegas. That's where most of the big shows take place. And then we do matchmaking for you at those shows. Upcoming, we have the Natural Products Expo in March in Anaheim. And we're going to be bringing, I think, 35 delegations from overseas with buyers to meet with U.S. companies attending that show. Certified trade fairs, these are shows on the international side that the U.S. Department of Commerce has given its stamp of approval. This is a good show for U.S. companies to attend to. And we often do matchmaking at those shows as well. And then single company promotion is a customized event for you in a country to meet with targeted partners. So an example, Hawaiian Airlines came to us a few years ago. They were celebrating their 50th anniversary, and they wanted to highlight their route in Australia. So we did a cocktail reception featuring the U.S. ambassador and Hawaiian Airlines, and all the VIPs in the travel and tourism sector in Australia came together. We had hula and Hawaii food, and it was all about promoting Hawaiian Airlines in that market. We also had a pet products company, and they wanted to meet with veterinarians in Taiwan and Hong Kong, so we organized a luncheon where they got to present to about 30 veterinarians in each market, and they connect with them as well at the show. It's not always the best mechanism, depending on the market. For instance, in Japan, you probably want to meet with those partners one-on-one. A group setting might not be as effective, but in some markets, and depending on who your target is, it can be very effective. Next slide, please. Finding a partner. Number three of the most important things you need to do to be successful in exporting. Has anyone heard of the Gold Key Service? Okay, great. The Gold Key Service is probably our most popular service. And what that is, it's a matchmaking service where you tell us what kind of partners you're looking for. You're looking for a distributor, or maybe you're looking for a high-end retailer a la Nordstrom or Macy's or Whole Foods in Korea, in Japan, in Canada. My colleagues in that country will contact the partners that meet your criteria, tell them about your business. We may send over samples, and then we'll arrange pre-screened one-on-one meetings for you and those companies that have meet your criteria and have expressed interest. So it's a lot better than knocking on doors, going to a trade show, exchanging business cards with dozens of people that you have no idea what their capability is. Because we're the U.S. government, it shakes out less legitimate partners on the foreign side, gives you immediate credibility in the eyes of foreign partners, and can help. And also, because we arrange the venue, transportation, transit if necessary, it takes all the burden off of you to arrange that. And the cost for that service is just $700. If it's the first time you use it, it's $350, so tremendous value. International Partner Search is a similar upfront research as a Gold Key, but we provide you with a contact list at the end if you can't travel to the market. It's always so much better to go to the market if you can. You learn a lot more about your partners, what's happening in that country, and what their capabilities are. That's what I recommend. International Company Profile, this is a background check on potential firms. So if someone contacts you or you meet someone at a trade show, they say they really want to represent you and you're not quite sure if they're legitimate, what they represent, if they'd be a good partner, we can do a full background on their legal standing, financial standing, even send someone out from the embassy or their place of business to verify what they've shared with you. Featured U.S. Exporter, this is an online promotion where you can get a promotional blurb on our websites overseas for about 3 months. Super cheap, $150 for 5 countries, and it'll also drive sales to your website. Next slide, please.
Just to interrupt, yep. Tie this back to the first presentation of this morning from DBET. The High Step grant can cover some of this activity, right? Like the Gold Key Service or what have you. So just to go back, tie it all together.
Yeah, the STEP program is actually specifically encouraged, any grant funds you receive, specifically encouraged to utilize these services. Next slide, please. Consulting. So this is basically what we do every day. It's just helping companies to troubleshoot, to develop their strategy, figure out what the best path is for them, share market intelligence, navigate customs issues, documentation, logistics, protecting your intellectual property, all those important things that come up in the process of doing business internationally. And if you're bidding on a foreign contract, we can also do advocacy to promote Buy USA. Next slide, please. Some key resources for you. Our website, export.gov, it's got all the information on trade events, market research that I mentioned, webinars. Hawaii Export Support, this is our local website, and we have on there things related to Hawaii business, export events that may be of interest to you. Export-U.com, free export tutorials. This is a partnership between the Small Business Development Center Network nationally and our agency. And we put together about these 25-minute webinars on different subjects. And there's a great one on costing and pricing your products overseas, so you can check that out. And I probably want to add the High Step website on here, which has all the resources. I'm sure we talked about that earlier. Next slide, please. Cost of services. We're a government agency. We're not allowed to make any money. Congress requires that we do cost recovery whenever we're doing a service overseas, like a Gold Key. And I mentioned that already, $700 per company or $350 for the first time. And a lot of the things we can offer for free, such as counseling, market research reports, and then the fees there you see for the other services. Next slide, please. Strategic partners. Small Business Administration has export-specific loans. I'm sure you've heard about that. Ex-Im Bank can offer export credit insurance for you. This is a very inexpensive insurance policy that kicks in if your foreign partner doesn't pay you. Hawaii Foreign Trade Zone, where we are today. Hawaii Pacific Export Council, which is a nonprofit organization putting on this event today. State of Hawaii DBED, we have Mark and Jamie here in the room with us. WSSADA, if your product is agriculture or food-based and has at least 51% U.S. agriculture content, you can qualify for the branded and generic programs. They're now called the Fun Match and something else, the Connect programs. And basically what these programs also help you offset your travel costs, do a gold key, attend a trade show, and they bring in foreign buyers as well. Next slide. This is how people feel about us. It's pretty good. Now, one more chance to win the Basic Guide to Exporting. Can anyone, and I need you to raise your hand, tell me the top three most important keys to export success. Hand in the back here.
Coordination, good partnerships, do your homework.
Okay, maybe can you rephrase that last one?
Least resistance.
That's right. Great partners, motivation, and path of least resistance. Let's give this gentleman a hand right here. Great, thank you. Got a book for you. And then next slide, I think that's my contact details. So you can reach out to me at any time, whether it's related to the High Step program or in the future or any other thing that you want to talk about related to your export business, feel free to reach out and we can assist you. Do we have any questions? I know. I told you at the beginning it's going to be like drinking out of a fire hose. It's a lot of information to digest. And I actually took out about 50 slides, so I saved you a little bit of time.
There was one online question.
Okay, we have an online question.
Neighbor Island Resources from the U.S. Commercial Service, did they contact you in Honolulu, or is there somebody locally out there?
The question was, do we have resources on the neighbor islands? My office in Honolulu covers the entire state of Hawaii, and so people on the neighbor islands can reach out to me directly. Also, I travel over to the neighbor islands, partner with some of our local partners on island, and we'll do seminars usually about once every other year I'm able to get to each island. Yep.
Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? Yes, in the back.
If we're just starting to think about exporting, do you have any recommendations on like what we should do before maybe contacting you about additional help?
So the question was, if you're just thinking about exporting, what are the first steps you should take before contacting us? First thing is thinking about some of these things that I mentioned in the presentation, such as assessing your product potential. Do you already have a market in the US? Great. If you're just setting up your business, you're just getting going, I highly recommend connecting with the Small Business Development Center. Fantastic counselors there, and they can really help you to boost up your business domestically. And then once your business is healthy and you're ready to grow internationally, then that would be a good time to come reach out to us. Also, all the resources related to the High Step program. This is the third seminar of 12. So we have another 9 programs coming up, and I'd recommend attending as many of those as possible. You're going to gain lots of insights. You're going to learn from many of the speakers on various trade topics and some key markets. So I'd recommend tapping into some of those resources as well. And you might also check out the Basic Guide to Exporting. What's cool about this book, it's kind of like a textbook on doing business internationally. It has about a dozen chapters, and at the end of each chapter is a case study on a U.S. company, some of the challenges they faced internationally, and then how they overcame them in doing business. And it's free online on export.gov. Yes?
As well as everything that we've talked about today, with any of these resources, how do you have something for website, like say adding on your products, updating your products, and also search engines, becoming a global market that way?
Okay, so the question was about e-commerce and beefing up your website for international sales. Couple things. First of all, I mentioned the Fuse program. Mm-hmm. For $150, you can pick 5 countries. You have an advertisement on our embassy website in that country. That can drive traffic to your website. The other thing that's probably more important is because a U.S. Embassy website is linked to thousands of websites in a country, it boosts your website in search engine listings tremendously. So that's kind of a low-cost first step to get a boost in country.
And that's Fuse.
That's the Fuse program. You can find it on export.gov/Fuse. And typically our Japan office recommends this service before you go to Japan for a trade show, because it'll get potentially interested partners to go to the website, check out a little bit about what's happening with your business, before you come, and then they're more interested in meeting with you. We also have an e-commerce guide for export on our website on export.gov, and it's about 2 years old. I'm not sure if we're updating it. We have a few videos on e-commerce for export as well. One big trend we've seen is cross-border e-commerce in places like China, where you might maintain an inventory of your products in Hong Kong or in southern China, and then as orders come through your website, you can have them drop shipped through those service providers. So that's another way to access the market where you're going to avoid a lot of the hurdles you might typically encounter by going direct to market. And then we also recently stood up something called the e-commerce innovation lab, and this is where we're trying to help out companies in refining their e-commerce export strategy. And it's in the beginning stages, but I expect as that e-commerce learning lab stands up, we're going to see more and more resources coming out of it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions? Great. Well, thank you very much, everyone. And feel free to reach out anytime. And I also want to thank our partners, Rob at the Hawaii Pacific Export Council, Jamie and Mark at DBED for helping to make this happen, and our partners at SBDC here who are doing a great job in counseling you and getting you ready to send our way. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bear with me while I switch presentations again. Our next presenter will be from UPS. This next section module of the course is based on logistics, and that's shipping and transportation of your products. Deirdre Soong is from UPS. Her colleague, Peter Stams, is on the Hawaii Pacific Export Council board with me. And we thank UPS greatly because they're very involved in what we're doing. And they're always eager to come and talk to companies that are interested in exporting. For a company like UPS, they're very much a soup to nuts provider of logistics support, meaning they can educate you on all parts of the exportation process, the logistics of that, as Deirdre will explain. But essentially, there's many aspects to shipping a product, from the insurance part of it, to picking it up, to actually moving the product to where it needs to be, to importation of the product, and then storing it locally, if it has to be refrigerated or what have you. We've worked with a lot of companies in Hawaii that are selling things like soaps, chocolates, things like that, that you can imagine can't be stored in very heated environments and what have you. And so you need to think about all of these things, but a company like UPS can certainly come and talk to you about all that and consult with you on how they would do it and what's the best practices in that world. And you can learn a lot by just having a meeting with one of these senior account representatives, and they're very familiar with this activity already. So one of the things I find when I'm consulting with the local companies here is everybody feels like they're the first person to do what they're trying to accomplish, right? It seems like across the board, everybody feels like, oh my gosh, nobody's ever been through what I'm going through right now. And that's absolutely not the truth. People like this can come in and tell you exactly how to ship the product, how much it's going to cost. If you ship one, you ship 100, you ship 100,000 of them, they can tell you everything you need to know. So please reach out and consult, get the consultation of people like Deirdre. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to you, but I know you have a couple videos that are on YouTube. Just bear with me when you want those videos. Okay. It's going to take me a second to fire it up and get it out to the webinar. And can you just hold that? And later, if anybody asks questions.
Okay. I feel like starting.
It's your lightsaber, yes. Yeah.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Deirdre Soong, and I'm with UPS. I've been with the company about 26 years. And so just a little bit about, I just want to first of all thank Rob and the Hawaii Pacific Export Council and DBED for having us here. We're always very happy to share and dispense information. We're also interested in partnering with people that are looking to export or have any kind of questions on UPS services. I'm part of a business development team here in Hawaii, and there's some other counterparts as well as myself that were accessible to be able to talk with you about domestic business as well as international business. So a little bit about my background with UPS is I started and I was hired off the street 26 years ago, and I thought when I first interviewed, I thought, well, how hard is it to move and sell a package moving from A to B, right? I mean, how hard could that be? And 26 years later forward, UPS is not known as just moving a package, but now we're really moving into that space of being a global logistics provider. And it is much more complicated looking at somebody's supply chain. So how do you bring goods in, as well as how do you move products out? Where do you source your raw materials? How do you store them? How do you finance them? How do you look at all those different types of pieces? So this presentation is really designed to just kind of be a broad stroke overview, high level of just basic exporting, right? But beyond that, there's always opportunities to have one-on-one discussions with us about what would work best for your companies. Because for UPS, it's all about really partnering with people to understand your specific business and understand how we can customize solutions that would meet your needs, as opposed to just a cookie cutter approach to your business. But before we get started, right, let's just have some fun. So by a show of hands, just tell me, when you think of UPS, how many of you think of the brown trucks? Okay, that's pretty good. I mean, most of you, right? Brown and the drivers in uniform, right? Okay. But how many of you also think of maybe the Amazon deliveries that you get or the deliveries that come to your house? Well, okay. Now, when you think of UPS, would you also think of UPS as a financial partner, somebody that would help you with asset-based lending? Or if you have credit cards and you have merchant services needs, would you think of UPS in that light? Anybody? No. Okay. Would you think of UPS as somebody who moves animals? Anybody? So those are kind of some of the other areas that UPS looks at, right? So in regards to the financial portion, UPS has a financial arm called UPS Capital, which looks at helping our customers with different type of financial solutions. That's one thing. UPS does customized solutions for people that need to move animals. So like the movie George of the Jungle, most of you remember. The animals that came into Hawaii to film were secretly put on the UPS plane in containers that were custom built for them, and they had temperature control so that they could be moved into here to be filmed. So those are some of the things that people don't necessarily think when you first think of UPS, right? The other thing is, how many of you would think that UPS actually has 9 full-time pharmacists on staff? Anybody? So UPS has 9 pharmacists in Louisville, Kentucky that manages our health care. So we have critical needs that need to be, whether it's human tissue, whether it's cancer medication, whether it's something that's needed for an emergency surgery. Those things are stored at UPS. And as soon as the need is there, it goes right out. So we have a fulfillment and distribution side of UPS that handles that as well. So what the goal really for today is to just kind of give you a broad stroke as to who UPS is, and beyond that is just to kind of help you with maybe the first steps in exporting, okay? So before we get started, just a little bit of trivia, because there's prizes, and everybody has a smartphone. So who can tell me, and raise your hand if you find the answer, when did UPS start business? What year was that?
19.
Nope. Don't go on that slide. Oh, wrong slide. Can you go to the... Yeah. Anybody?
1961.
It's not on this slide. I'll give you a hint. You have to go on your phone. Anybody? You'll be close. Anybody who's close gets a prize. Anyone? Okay, so UPS started in 1907. 110... years in the making, right? So it's been a long time that we've been in business. Now the next trivia, how many of you can tell us how many employees do we have worldwide? Take a guess.
Oh my gosh, it's got to be hundreds of thousands.
Prizes. Take a guess, any guess. It's all good. A little higher. Anybody? We have 444,000 employees worldwide. 362,000 are in the US, and the remaining 82,000 is in across the world. Okay? But anyway, if we could just go. Just what this represents, I'll just kind of go into that. This is sort of the evolution of the logos, right? So we started, imagine, UPS started with two teenagers who had a dream in a basement in Seattle. And that's how UPS started. And then they evolved into understanding that they could develop a company delivering packages from department stores to customers on their bicycles. And today, UPS, this is kind of how we move through the different logos. The logo in the middle is what you see today. We are a $58 billion company, ninth largest airline, and we deliver nearly 5 billion packages annually and about 18 million packages a day worldwide. So that's kind of just kind of gives you a lens of who we are. Okay, I'm going to go to the next slide. So how we feel that we can help customers best is most customers look at us and they see the drivers, the packages, right? What we wanted to just sort of, this gives you an indication of where, what else we have. Beyond just the packages moving domestically and internationally, we have the financial arm that we talked about. We have distribution and logistics. So we do a lot with companies. If you're starting a company and let's say you go into a warehouse and you think, I don't even know how I'm going to lay out my warehouse. We do studies and analysis on warehouse optimization as an example. We look at different ways to help you become efficient in your pull, pick, and pack and your order flow beyond before it even gets out the door. And then beyond that, UPS doesn't only have trucks. The way that we move products is through air freight, ocean freight, through our airplanes, our trucks, through rail. So there's any other intermodal that you can think of, we probably can address that with you. Okay, next slide. And then I think you're going to want to tee up the video when you get a chance. Well, so
tell me exactly when you want
to. Okay, got it.
It's complicated.
Okay. So really what we're trying to show you is that we're in about 220 countries and territories worldwide. And then on the ground, we have about 230 airplanes of our own, but on a daily basis, at least 500 aircraft are utilized to move things domestically as well as globally. And about 99,000 in our fleet of delivery vehicles and other type of things. So this is just kind of a snapshot of the UPS services that we offer internationally, right? So we can get it there based on time definite needs that you might have, or if you have the opportunity to wait a few days, then there are deferred services as well as we can move larger freight opportunities as well. Okay, and then if you want to go to maybe the next slide. Yeah, perfect. So when you're looking at exporting, and certainly maybe we could, the videos we could send it out or something.
Sure.
Links, yeah, maybe
that
would be good.
I'll link to the video.
Yeah. So that first video was just really a quick time lapse of what happens in our main air hub in Louisville each night. There's multiple sorts that happen. And then there's another video that is going to show you just a little bit about the basics of when you're looking to export. What kind of things are you looking for? So really the first couple things that you want to look at is your product, first of all, exportable? Some of the things that John talked about previously, certainly those are important to look at as well, right? But you want to look at what kind of regulations they might have. Do certain countries have embargoes or prohibited articles that they don't allow in that might be looking at for your particular product, right? And then beyond that, UPS tradability is on our UPS site, there's a lot of resources internationally on how to start, how to help small businesses, how to do international transactions or even domestic transactions. But UPS tradability is a really great tool on our site that allows you to be able to look at How do you calculate the landed cost? What's going to be involved for the customer when it gets to that country? What's the duty and tax that's going to be assessed? Maybe what's the harmonized code that you need on your product in order for customs to accurately clear that package? There's just different resources on UPS.com. Next slide, please.
I would add, I've used that many, many times, and it's incredibly useful. And it's a free account.
Mm-hmm. And so it's really just a way of you being able to look at grabbing information up front. The key, just like John had mentioned, is really about being proactive and diligent before you even ship any of the product out to make sure that you understand what potential limitations there will be as far as quantity, as far as commodity, as far as what type of maybe licenses might be required on the import. All these different things, or maybe what specific governments require upon entry. These things are accessible through UPS.com, and you just go and search under tradability. All you would need is a UPS account, which you can register for online, and a password. So it's just a great resource. It doesn't cost anything. It's free of charge, like Rob mentioned, and it's just something that would help you at least as you're exploring whether you want to export. Next slide, please. The other critical thing with exporting is the commercial invoice. How many of you know what a commercial invoice? Anybody? Okay. So just think of a commercial invoice as a passport for the package. Just like we need a passport when we go to a different country in order for them to allow us in, this is the same thing for a package. The package needs to be able to say to the customs clearing or the customs agent, hey, this is the package, this is what it contains, and this is the information where it was manufactured, and this is the value. So what happens is the customs in whichever country you're sending to will look at this documentation and then decide what is the duty and tax that they're going to assess on this particular good. So you think, okay, that seems pretty straightforward, right? But imagine we've seen in our industry that, let's say you're sending a t-shirt. So you just think, okay, under the description, I'm going to put t-shirt. So it goes into customs, they clear it, except that they look at it, and then that customs agent says, well, is it a woman's t-shirt, or is it a 100% cotton, or is it a blend, 50 blend? Is it a long sleeve versus a short sleeve? As much as that seems silly, that could indicate a big difference in the duty and tax, because if you imagine these agents all have these volumes and, you know, resources of different things, and they're going to assess the duty and tax based on the description. So the one takeaway would be, under commercial invoices, the description should be as accurate as possible. 50% cotton, 50% poly, long sleeve men's t-shirt is what you would want to put instead of just t-shirt, because that could be the difference between a lower duty and tax than a higher duty and tax. Okay. So that commercial invoice is key. It's really something that's very important to have on your packages. Now, UPS can help with that because we have what's called a paperless invoice. Now, the critical with that is that when you use the UPS shipping system, that you can generate this commercial invoice right through the system, and we send electronic information to customs while it's still in the air flying over to the country. We try to pre-clear and pre-alert most of the shipments before they even land. That will help then reduce the amount of clutter or customs clearance that's necessary to get it through customs, okay? So that's another benefit of using UPS is the customs, the paperless invoice that we use. Next slide, please. That's the paperless. And it would also help you to reduce up to 52% of the customs holds. So that's a critical. Next slide, please. So now, once you've kind of looked at moving it, you've got the documentation, right? The other part of it is the brokerage piece. So some people understand that if they elect to have their own broker, that's another layer that you have to kind of, the broker would act on your behalf to help clear it through customs. With UPS, what we do is we have our own in-house customs brokerage team that acts on your behalf. So from the time that we pick it up through the time that we deliver it, we act on your behalf. We go to customs and we make sure to help clear the packages. We also make sure that that rate is included within the shipping rate. So at least that way you're not thinking, okay, I've got the shipping charges plus I've now got brokerage fees, right? So that's something else to think about. Next slide, please. So of course, everyone's talking about e-commerce and the drive now is e-commerce, right? And as we talk about that, it's something that over as it continues, as the years go on, right, in our system, we see just continual surges in volume that comes through the big giants, the obvious ones like Amazon. We have a lot of e-commerce, small business customers that do e-commerce out of their garage and they're doing very well and they're moving it through, right? The world is shrinking and e-commerce is now just a household. It's everything that we all talk about. We all order online. It's not even like we think about it, right? We don't care where it comes from as long as it gets in on time. So something to think about, right, when you're looking at your businesses, 95% of the global consumers are actually outside of the US. So as we talked about, I think some of the other speakers talked about, it's important to have a healthy domestic business, right? To have your solid foundation in your business with domestic markets. The growth is gonna come internationally. That's what we're seeing with our customers, with the trends that we see as well, is that because 95% of the consumers are outside the US, your focus, you're going to wanna look at how do you learn how to grow your exports. Emerging countries are something that people are starting to understand. It's not just the obvious like the Japans or Asia, it's India. It's those type of countries that are coming up, they're building their infrastructure. And the interesting thing is 100% of growth worldwide for B2C e-commerce type of transactions is expected in the next few years, but 200% more people by 2030 worldwide will become middle class. So once they become middle class, they start to upscale, they start to want more things, they become more savvy shoppers, right? So that focus, when you're looking at your business, really that's what we talk with our customers a lot, is looking at how do you export in addition to the lanes that are obvious lanes, but maybe you're looking at, is there opportunity for you to grow your business in lanes that are emerging from emerging companies, that they're building that middle class, that they're starting to have more income, they're starting to understand how to use their disposable income. Okay, next slide, please. So some of the things that are pinch points, right? As you're a shipper and shopper relationship, when you're talking about e-commerce, as a merchant or a shipper, you're looking at, okay, is my product exportable, right? Now, you also worry about fraud. You also worry about how do you make that customer experience favorable so that they want to keep coming back to your website. From the shopper's experience, it's sort of like, okay, how much am I expected to pay for duty and taxes, or is it an easy process for me to use the website? What kind of payment methods or return policies do they have? Do I have to pay for returns? Those type of questions come up, right? Next slide, please. So really the five keys to growing, enabling your business, right, is you really want to try to localize your website so that it's a favorable customer experience. What do we mean by that, right? So if your customer is in Portugal, then localizing your website so that it has the ability for the customer to see it in their language, in their currency, to be able to calculate the duty and tax on those goods while they're shopping is an important piece, okay? Fully landed costs, that's what we just talked about, payment plans, looking at speed and cost and what type of options they have to ship it. Next slide, please. So through UPS, there's a process called iGlobal in which there is software and there's other access that you can have that helps you to embed and work with us on your website to look at how do you design your website to have that country localization or to alert you to fraudulent activities or to be able to say, I want to be able to ship to these certain countries, but I do know that these countries have a high fraud rate. So I want to be able to put some logic into the website design and say, okay, let's not ship to these countries because we know that we've experienced some fraud. There's just different types of things that you can do to try to help your business thrive and export, but also be able to have some of these things that would help access your website and make it more of a favorable experience for your customer. Next slide, please. So as an example, right, this is a customer who is on this website. They're in Portugal. And now if they weren't in Portugal, there's a pull down that they could pull and say, okay, I'm in Japan or I'm in another country. And what it would do is it would then show them different options. If they want to see it in their currency, what kind of payment do they have? What shipping options do they have? And then any estimate on the duty and tax that they would expect to pay on those goods. Next slide, please. So as you can see, right, in this case, this customer is in Canada. And so as they check out, they're able to see it in their currency. And so that whole transition from what they see in English versus what they see in their country and in their currency, that seems to be, when we talk to a lot of e-commerce customers and we look at solutions, these type of solutions are what they're looking for. They're looking for that local personalization that enhances that customer experience. And we have that, you know, from our standpoint, that's the kind of capital and intellectual capital that we want to be able to share with customers, whether you're a small business, whether you're medium, or whether you're a large corporate account. Those are important things, and there's a lot of studies that are done on the type of what the pulse of an online shopper is and stuff like that. So there's, again, those type of resources. I don't want to go too far into it, but there's, you know, many of that type of resources are located on our website as well. And next slide, please. So this one says, go, got business in Hong Kong. But obviously, right, we're looking for to help you folks in any way we can in exporting. UPS does have a flight that directly leaves from here into Hong Kong directly. So if you do have an opportunity or you do have business in Hong Kong, then that's certainly a specific lane that we can talk about. But beyond that, UPS does fly to, like I said, it was over 700 airports daily across the globe. So we have major hubs in Germany, as well as Asia, as well as Europe and China. There's a lot of different things that we can help you with as far as export. So I kind of went through a lot of things and went all over the place, but I guess if there's any questions, feel free to come back and talk to me in the back. But if I'll open it up right now for questions from anyone.
You should glass.
We do. So what we would look at is there are packaging guidelines that we could help a customer with as far as how much insulation is needed within the packing. We would look at that. For customers that, you know, maybe let's say that they might have had damages in the past, whether it be with UPS or another carrier, we also have a package design and test lab that does actually look at reviewing a customer's current packaging and then making recommendations on improvements to it. So they will run it through like a litany of different tests, compression, vibration, shock, you know, whatever it is, and then come back and make some recommendations. So we ship, and the video had showed it too, I mean, we currently from Hawaii, just as an example, the diversity of what we ship live koi, to Canada next day, as well as domestically. We ship probably a lot of the cookies that cookies and chocolates. We ship fresh fish to restaurants across the U.S. So a lot of perishables, we ship ice cream. So those would be the ones that you don't really think of. But in those cases, we have looked at refinement of their packaging. Sometimes the ice cream needs a little bit different packaging than the live koi does.
Ship honeybees?
We ship bees currently, yes we do. And those bees actually have It's interesting, their packaging, they need to have air. So the corrugated carton has a little screen that allows airflow into it, right? And so the planes as well, we're very sensitive to that. So the bees might need a certain temperature versus the papayas that get imported. Or, you know, of course, maybe the t-shirt doesn't really care, but maybe the live things do. So the plane, the pilots have the ability to temperature control certain sections of the plane based on our client. Yes. Anybody else?
If something ships by air, or let's say UPS is picking up something in, Kihei, mm-hmm. and they want to ship it to Osaka, mm-hmm. how does it get there? What's the routing roughly?
So it would probably flow through Honolulu. We have an international department here that would move it directly from here out to Japan. So there's a couple of different ways that we would look at the lane. It doesn't necessarily have to go back to the U.S. and then back. We do move a lot of our Asia pack things directly from here.
That's what I would
say.
Yeah. Important.
Definitely. Time-wise, right? And
sure.
Yeah. So just to kind of give you a sneak peek of UPS, Rob is going to cue up a video. And this is of our main air hub in Louisville, Kentucky, where hundreds of packages are sorted every day. It's probably about 2 million a day that get delivered through there. So this is kind of more like a behind the shield, you know, behind the scenes. It kind of gives you an idea of the perspective of what happens. This is our facility that you saw is our main domestic air hub in the U.S. There are 7 others, and we do have 6 others across the world as well. Just to give you a perspective, it's about 90 football fields. And as far as 5 stories, 155 miles of conveyor belt. So the goal in that facility is really to try to keep the least amount of touching to that package. So when you saw them offloading those packages, once they hit the belt, there's smart sensors all around, and that the packages are actually what we call polite packages, because they actually, as they merge onto, if you imagine like merging onto a freeway, right, they kind of have to wait. So there's sensors that will tell the packages, don't go too close to the other package. So in any given window, those packages probably only have 20 minutes to get offloaded before they have to take their departure. So I, you know, from being from Hawaii, a lot of our packages were last in. So it's kind of a crunch to get, you know, that fish has to be at that restaurant in Florida tomorrow. So literally the flight will be the last one in. It gets into the building and it may take it needs to get onto that plane in 20 minutes. And maybe it takes it 16 minutes to get through that 155 miles of conveyor, gets on the flight, and then it makes a next day service into Florida. So the chef's happy, right? Or Whole Foods is happy when they get their ice cream. So it's just, we look at it as
how do we help customers, even from our perspective? It's about increasing technology and investing a lot in technology to help make sure that we are sensitive about package care of our customers' packages. How do we improve it through visibility so that you folks can see tracking, right? I think our website has 65 million views per day on tracking. And so just different things like that. We have different tools that are, we're always looking to try to partner with our customers to give you some of that knowledge and some of that to help run your business more effectively. So thank you very much. Please come talk to me after. We'd be happy to sort of do a one-on-one if you're interested in talking a little bit more specifically about your businesses or any other questions that you have. And thank you for your time.
Any questions right now? I would just reiterate that shipping, if you haven't done it before, shipping a package internationally is easy if you have the right partner doing it. You can manage as an exporter. You can manage every little step of the way incrementally if you want. You can book a plane or a ship. You can book a freight forwarder. You can buy insurance. You can have somebody at the destination company working for you to import the product. You can have another company deliver it. All of that can be arranged by you individually, but it's extremely complicated. The video, I think, was really good because it shows when you ship a package, how many hands actually touch that package. I mean, not necessarily fingertips, but how many different people are involved in moving a package to, say, Singapore. I mean, it's really easy to ship a package to Singapore, but there's so many steps along the way. In a company like UPS, you don't know all of those steps. You just give it to the guy in the brown shirt, and the guy in a brown shirt delivers it, right? But, and that's all you know about, and then you see a price for that, and your customer sees a price, right? So it's so much easier just dealing with UPS. That's why we're thrilled to have them here, and you're going to hang out for a few minutes,
yeah,
and so
sure.
She'll have one-on-ones with you if you're very curious about that. But if they're not, how do they find you in the future?
So I will definitely leave some cards so that our team can get in touch with you, and that way if there's anything that you have questions on, we really are a firm believer in partnership. So sometimes the question that you think, oh, maybe they probably can't do it, that's probably the question that you should ask us, because over the last, like I said, the evolution of UPS, what we look like before and what we can do today, totally different. And a lot of our customers think we might still be only able to deliver packages, but there are a vast amount of other solutions that maybe could help you and that don't even have anything to do with the package, but maybe just about managing your business smarter or more efficiently. Okay. Thank you.
One question came in.
Yes.
Everybody's asking about neighbor islands. How, if somebody's on Maui or the Big Island,
yes,
or somehow, are there people like you there, account managers locally, or how do they find that out?
So our business development team has three of us, and what happens is we also do go to the outer islands and we cover the whole state of Hawaii.
Okay.
So if there's any opportunity there, for sure. And if you have, let's say you have partners that you source from different countries, UPS is on the ground in 220 countries that we service, right? So there are opportunities for our sales team or our operations team to even talk to your suppliers or anything else to help to make that whole process, right, from the beginning of the supply chain to the end, as seamless and as easy as possible. So that's also something we can do too.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you so
okay.
much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Come see me.
All right, we have very, very few minutes left to get out of here by 1 o'clock. So I'm going to take a quick vote from everybody because both of these topics would be me coming up. Do you want to hear about IT, like e-commerce, that sort of thing? Or do you want to hear about marketing? What do you prefer? E-commerce? And we're having specific courses on these things later. So I'm only going to do a very broad brush of this. And you come back later for our next courses, and I'll go through a lot of these things in a lot more detail. So I'm going to blaze through this one real quick. It's not just specifically e-commerce, but this is what, I'm a volunteer for this position, but this is sort of what my day job is about, selling stuff internationally. And so this is a presentation I've been giving for a while. What we're trying to do is get Hawaii small companies to use technology more to get out into the world and sell their products. IT solutions that are easily manageable and cheap or free to implement, that's what I'm after, and that's what I consult on people how to do that. An easy-to-use content management system such as WordPress, routinely updated, a bilingual or multilingual website. That's very easy for us to implement these days. My company does it constantly, all day long. Lots of Japanese, English websites, Korean, Chinese. There's two types of Chinese you need to worry about if you're going to the mainland or to Taiwan. We can set it up so that a user from that's coming from an IP address in Japan only goes to your Japanese language website. These things are easy. PayPal, I highly recommend getting PayPal for a smaller company. Just set it up and you can bill your customers in Japanese yen or dollars or Korean won or whatever they want to pay. I mean, sometimes you find Japanese customer wants to pay in euros for whatever reason. It's not your business. Who cares? As long as you get the US dollars at the end of the day. You want to make it as easy as possible for your customers to buy from you. So accept any currency. And through PayPal, you can do that very easily. Now, if you're accepting large amounts of money, which I hope you get to at some point, PayPal's probably not the best solution, but at least for small companies, it's great. And when I was first starting my career, nothing like that existed, right? We had to have letters of credit and all of these things, very complicated mechanisms. But now you can do everything through PayPal. Of course, PayPal takes a commission on that, but so what? So what, right? That's the way it works. If you're sending products or trying to sell products in Asia, testimonials are extremely important, right? Don't forget that. Testimonial being, this was a great product. I wish I'd ordered it sooner. It's made my life so much better. My family loves me more. Whatever, Dave in Osaka or something, right? Testimonials go a very long way in Asia. Another thing that you can easily do on your website for free is implement Google Analytics behind the scenes. You don't have to have a lot of IT skill, but certainly your website developer, if you hire somebody to make the site bilingual, what have you, they can easily implement Google Analytics. So you know who's coming to your website, what language was their computer based on, where were they? Were they in Osaka? Were they in Tokyo? Were they in Vietnam? Very specifically what's going on there. Social media is so easy now, right? Instagram getting very popular in Asia. Certainly in Japan, lots of Instagram, lots of Facebook, LinkedIn, if that's more in line with your company's goals. You have to update it regularly, though. Don't do it once a year. Do it monthly. Do it weekly. Don't have large gaps in between your first post and your second post and your third post. Just build it into your schedule that you're going to update your social media regularly. Customer relationship management software. There's lots of free ones out there or very cheap so that you can track when was the last time you talked to Mr. So-and-so or Miss who is that, what's her name. You can keep track of all of that stuff. So I haven't talked to that person in 3 months. I really need to reach out to them and get a grip on what they're doing. Ask your customers for feedback. That's extremely important. We don't do that enough in this country or in Hawaii specifically. Ask them, how are we doing? What can we do better? Telephone, you can easily set up a telephone number in a foreign country for about $5 a month. It'll ring to your phone here. Simple. It shows the customers in that country that you're very eager to do business there. You're willing to set up a phone number and what have you. Now, somebody calls, you got to answer that number. Or at least you can have a voicemail in their language. I think that that really goes a long way for $5-6 a month, right? But if you could answer that in their language, even with remedial Japanese or something, hey, that shows you're really serious. And eventually, if you get an employee over there or an agent over there, you could point that phone number to ring to them, right? It's a great service, and these things are so easy and cheap to set up through Ring Central, this VoIP Dito, Skype. Wow, so many choices out there that didn't exist even 5 or 10 years ago, right? You can set up a number in Vietnam, you know? Who even thought 20 years ago, you didn't even think they don't have phones in Vietnam, right? Now you could set up these things to ring to you in Maui or wherever you are. You travel, it'll follow you. You go travel to a hotel, you can have it ring to your hotel, however you want. It's very simple. Online forums, these types of things are very important. In some markets, text messaging is huge. Singapore and Hong Kong, text messaging ads are very important. And most people don't get irritated with it, actually. Here, if you get a text message ad from somebody, you're very, you know, your blood pressure goes up instantly, right? But there, it's pretty common. You know, people glance at it and they just delete it quickly, but at least their eyeballs saw your message. So don't take things, for example, that are taboo here, marketing taboos here. They don't necessarily translate elsewhere, but there may be taboos there that we're doing here. Lots of website chats, that's very common now. You've all seen that, where you go to a chat with somebody. Mostly it directs you to some website in the Philippines or India, but you could set up a website chat with a Japanese customer. Sometimes that's a very easy way to do things. Communicate with few typed words rather than emails, which can be long and complicated, or telephone messages, which are difficult if you don't speak the same language. But if you're just chatting through Google Chat or something like that, it's very effective, actually. E-surveys and questionnaires, I talk about this a lot. If I'm consulting to companies on marketing issues, for example, what if, ask these questions, what if questions. What if we had a product that could do this, and what if it cost about this much, and what if it was made in Hawaii, what if. And we find that you get such fantastic answers back from people based on this type of information. What if, right? Very easy, very simple, gives the customers ample opportunity to think about it and give you a reasonable, cogent response. Now, one of the things we find, if you're building out a website in Japanese, for example, let's say in Hawaii, you'll have a lot of people who say, oh, well, you know, my auntie, she's married to a guy who spent a lot of time in Japan when he was younger, and he can translate our website for us and things like that. No. When they read it in Japanese, it'll look like, I don't know, you've all read a manual from a company, a Japanese manufacturer of a DVD player or something. You read anything, I kind of get it, but it's awkward, right? And that's how Japanese that was generally written in Hawaii, that's how it reads in Japan. It's they kind of get it, but it's very awkward. So you want to have a professional look at your documents or your website that you're translating. And it's not expensive. But if your product is very niche-y, then you may have to get it read by somebody, proofread by somebody who's specific to that industry, because some words are just very specific to certain industries, right? And that works in other languages. Business cards, get bilingual cards. That's easy to do here in Hawaii, very straightforward. QR codes, you've all seen those black and white codes on the back. People use them on cards. Very common in Asia, and it can direct the user on your card straight away to your website, or put your contact information in their phone. Here's my business card here, English on one side, this card, and then there's a big QR code in the back. So all anybody has to do at a trade show is scan that in,
and my contact information will go right into their contact database, and it'll take them to the website. But you could do that too for a promotion. Like, let's say you had 25% off if you got my website information from my business card, right? You could build that into this QR code. They go to your website automatically when they scan this, and it has a 25% off code right there, right? That's great. It's free. It's free to make that. I mean, of course, you have to pay to print the cards, but it's free to make a QR code. Should use it. Let's see. After sales service in Asia tends to be more complicated than it is here, meaning the customer's expecting more of the relationship than it is here, generally speaking. It's not completely true, but generally speaking. So when you ship something from here, you should send to the customer information about when is it going to get there, and you can get those that tracking information and what have you. But then after they receive it, you should reach out to them and say, how is it? They arrive on time, did it arrive in good shape, do you like it? These kinds of little after sales communications with the customers go really, really far in Asia, to the point where I would say in Japan you should think of it as expected. Right? If a company did that for you here, right? Let's say you ordered something from the mainland and it got arrived here, and that company actually called you or sent you a message and said, hey, did it arrive okay? Was it on time? Do you like it? Does it fit? Blah, 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 blah. That sort of thing. Wouldn't you be impressed by that? Right? You would think, wow. Right? And so I think that translates into Asia very well. Yeah, true.
A do not reply. So you're saying an actual person, not the
yeah,
reply.
Correct. I mean, a real person, you know. Right now, you're at the point where you don't have that many sales that it's going to bog you down, right? But eventually, you get to the point where you would want your local agent or a distributor there doing that sort of thing. They'll probably do it anyway, but it's better if the message is being driven by you, so it has your wording there, your logo on the message, the email, however you do it, instead of your agent and distributor, right? Lots of things I find are very helpful are sort of refer a friend type discounts. It goes back to the testimonials and what have you, but that's a great way for a small business to get their message out through sort of viral marketing, you know, pass along a code to your customers and say, okay, if your friend will buy a product, use this code, and they get 10% or 15% or something like that. It's very, very, very useful, particularly in Asia. When you travel, you will travel. There's no question about it. Particularly if you're taking some of the high-step grant money and you're traveling with those funds, track your expenses electronically. I have an app on here. It's called, it's great. It's called BIZ Expense Tracker. And I can take photos of receipts. I can put the currency that it was in. I think it costs $3 or $4, but it's totally worth it. I can say, for example, if I'm traveling on behalf of a client, I can say who that client was, I can say what the vendor was, like I stayed at Marriott, or I took a subway in Japan, I did this, I did that. And at the end, trust me, when you come back, especially if you're not used to traveling in foreign countries, you'll come back with 100 receipts, 98 of them you can't even read. Right? I don't know what that was. And so if you get in the habit of just tracking your expenses real easily and quickly as you do them, it makes your life so much simpler later on is how you aggregate your expenses for those trips. Apply for airline business accounts. They all have that, right? I am personally kind of married to the Delta system, and they have a system where, what do they call it? Sky Bonus. So it's just for your company, right? Of course, they have their regular mileage program, but your company, if you're an employee of the company, then the company buys tickets, and then the company accrues miles too. So you as the traveler and you as and the company both accrue miles, and you can use it that way. It's very good. Use an airline credit card. Again, I have a Delta Amex card, so anytime that I'm buying something, I'm using that card and I get miles so that I can turn those miles again later into free trips back to where I need to be traveling in order to sell my products and goods. That's a great system for me. And another thing is, most of my career, it was egregiously expensive to stay in hotels in Asia, Tokyo, Seoul, Singapore, now Beijing, Shanghai. The hotels are really expensive, but Airbnb is growing like gangbusters in Asia. So you can find relatively cheap places to stay, even in Tokyo, nice apartments or what have you. They're very safe, clean, for 50, 60 bucks a night, right? Not 400, 450, 500 bucks a night, right? So I highly recommend looking into that. Again, there's very broad strokes, but what we're trying to do is teach you about simple, cheap, possibly even free ways to implement technology in order to get your products and services out there. I did this in like 20 minutes, but I could speak to this in a whole half of a day. So please look for those types of events that are coming up on the schedule this year, or feel free to contact me anytime about questions like this. And I can certainly speak at length on this and marketing too, but I consider the two sort of very much interrelated, particularly if you're trying to sell products internationally. You're based on a small island in the middle of the ocean and you're trying to sell products to Asia or wherever around the world, you're definitely going to be using technology. So that's why I consider the marketing and the IT are all very much sort of intertwined. And it's often hard to separate the two. But I do have a separate presentation on marketing, which I'll be giving in a few weeks. So if I'll open it up for questions, but please feel free to contact me anytime. I'm very easy to reach. My office is just over in the old building here. Anybody? Okay, great. Thank you. So with that, we close the program for today. I hope you found it educational. I know we are speaking in very broad strokes with the presentations that were here today. Look again at the schedule events that are coming up. We have a full day of, or half a day anyway, of logistics. We UPS will be here again. We have a half a day of legal, finance. I already addressed marketing. We'll be doing that. We have a big event on Taiwan that's very country specific. Another event on China, very country specific. Cultural issues at towards the end. I think in late August we have cultural issues. We have a day dedicated to just the Tokyo International Gift Show, which I think will be that'll be really interesting. How to work a trade show booth, how to do all of those types of things, and a little bit of the cultural aspect of how to hand out business cards and do that sort of thing. I think it's very important stuff to know. So again, I hope you found it educational. Please stick around because the UPS people will be in the back and be able to answer any questions. Jamie Lum from DBET's here if you have any questions for her. I'll be around for a while if you have any specific questions for me. But with that, thank you very much for coming. I hope you come back for our further events. Thanks.